Okay. So, I can hear me son. So, theoretical frameworks. So, this is what this PowerPoint is about, and it's an in-depth look into film theory and film criticism. So, like, what is film theory? So, to put it in the most simple way, film theory is a way in which people break down movies and films and put television programs using a variation of approaches, including conceptual frameworks that help us understand their relationship with society and the real world. A film theorist is a bit like a surgeon in that they'll cut open the film and have a look inside to see what makes it all tick and work. And you know what I mean? They break down the film and analyze it using the knowledge of the current society and the world in which they inhabit. It's best to have a basic understanding of film theory in order to make it in any part of the film industry, as you can't help create a new and unique story without knowing what came before, basically. So how to analyze a film. So next slide, I'm going to go through a few different elements and frameworks and all that, and that'll come into play when you help it so you can understand how to analyze a film. Next slide, please. So film criticism and film theory. Now, before we get into some examples, I've just got to like say how similar these two are. So there are two main elements used when trying to read a film, although different, both criticism and theory are vital to being able to read a film. Criticism is a practice usually done by journalists or scholars to help investigate a film to give it a review for the public. And now that's clear, let's go into some examples. So, one of my favorite films, Cloverfield, I had to get it in here. It's one of my favorite films ever made, not only because it takes the sort of cheap looking knockoff camcorder style that you see in like the Blair Witch and all that, it takes it and elevates it. But I also like it because it's got a very deep and relevant meaning at the time the film was made. The choice to have a monster attacking the city it might at first glance seem like an overdone concept after about 1,000 Godzilla movies, but quite the contrary, the choice of a monster within this film is actually an extremely clever choice, as it can be used as a metaphor. Now, giant monsters, or kaiju, if you must, are often used in films as a way to reflect the current state of the world back on to reflect the current state of the world back onto the audience that's watching. For instance, when the first Godzilla movie came out in 1954, Japan was still recovering from the nuclear bombings by America in 1945. So having a monster who is literally fueled by radiation, and he's literally made of radiation, attack Tokyo is a clear nod to the fear that was still lingering at the time after the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So there's clear similarities between Cloverfield and 9/11. If you put two and two together, you can start to see just how clearly the film is based on the September 11th attacks. The choice of New York City as the setting is a huge giveaway in itself, as obviously that's where the September 11th took place. And even if you look at the poster, if I don't know if you can see it because of the screens, but if you look at the poster, it's very reminiscent of how the city looked on that day with the Statue of Liberty. Well, its head's ripped off, but you know what I mean? Looking at the smoke coming from the buildings. Also, the choice of a monster is obviously supposed to represent the terrorists who committed the attack. The monster is hardly seen on screen, and I think that isn't meant to represent how we kind of don't know where threats are or when we'll strike next. We only kind of see glimpses of these people, which is how people of America, this kind of like fear of these terrorists just appearing and not knowing when they'll come next. This must be the fear that America must have felt after those attacks for years. So I just want to show you a quick clip that I think kind of it I think in this little clip, it shows 9/11 and the state of America at that time in this little clip, literally. Let's see if it play.
Man, what is going on? Maybe you should have left town a little bit earlier, right?
No, I didn't see that. Sorry, I meant to try and pause the video then just to say my piece. Okay.
Man, what is going on?
Okay, so the bit where that explosion happens. So previously, before this scene, the ground shakes like an earthquake. So they're all outside going, what's just happened? And I think it's very reminiscent of when the first tower was hit during 9/11 and no one actually kind of knew what had happened. They were all just outside going, what was that? What just happened? And then the explosion that occurs then is obviously a reference to the second tower blowing up and everybody seeing that. Now, that second tower blowing up, kind of, you then see the fear, I feel like, of everybody at that one point. And I think going further into the clip, the bit that really, for me, represents 9/11 is this part. Our terrorism in America. In a way. Now, I think that single bit, that a few seconds, is the most powerful for me, because the Statue of Liberty is Liberty. It's the symbol of America in a way. It's the show of how strong America is. It's like an iconic statue there. It kind of represents like peace and the strength of America. And I think for that one shot for the monster to rip its head off and throw it, basically beheading, killing it, is basically representative of these of terrorists and a lot of these shootings that happen in America, kind of ripping the heart kind of America out and just leaving it on the street. Like, and for them all to see, so it throws it into the middle of the people going, look, here's your heart, and we've ripped it out and it's now just laid on the floor and it's nothing big. And it's even kind of subtly done as well when the monster hits the Empire State Building. And even in destroying that, I think the Statue of Liberty's head being ripped off is supposed to represent America having its heart ripped out, but the Empire State Building is situated in the middle of New York City. It is the heart of New York City. It's the first thing you see. And I think it destroying that tower is supposed to be like, it's a symbolic of how when the next September 11th attacks happened, it kind of hit the heart of New York City. It kind of ripped the heart out of New York City. And so I feel like the Statue of Liberty is representative of America being destroyed, and the Empire State Building is representative of New York then being vulnerable and having everything taken away from, having its heart basically ripped away from it. Okay, so next slide. Okay, so next element is Get Out, obviously a very favourite film of mine. And post-racial America, obviously very, can't think of the word, very popular right now, or as it was back in 2020. So what is Get Out? Get Out is a 2017 psychological thriller, horror if you must, film created by Jordan Peele. The film was created in response to the post-racial lie that was still sweeping across America. So the post-racial lie is this idea of everyone likes to pretend that racism isn't a thing anymore. Like, we've gone past the days of slavery and the 60s with Martin Luther King and all that. And no one wants to talk about race now. Everyone just feels like it's just happened and we're all okay now, when it's really not. And post-racial America basically started when Obama was elected on the 4th of November in 2008. And Obama was elected as President of the United States. And everyone at that point all of a sudden was like, okay, this black man's got into the White House. There's no longer anything holding people back now. Everyone's sort of made it. And obviously his election, he was the first ever black president. So it was very significant of no one is now being held back, or everyone can now, everyone who was like of a different ethnicity has equal life chances to a white person. And it's still a kind of a lie, which is what the post-racial America is. So Get Out and Black Lives Matter. So even though Get Out was made in 2017, I still feel like it was more relevant. It was probably before its time in a way, because it was more relevant last year than ever before. So throughout 2020, throughout 2020 just due to the Black Lives Matter protests that took place within America. The movement itself was obviously started in 2012 by Trayvon Martin. Trayvon Martin was killed by his neighborhood watch captain, but the movement really came to life in May 2020 when obviously the big famous George Floyd murder occurred. An all black man living in America was killed by a police officer. I don't think I have to go into detail because we obviously know what happened with that. And after the murders of Breonna Taylor, Rayshard Brooks and Daniel Prude, many names of, that's just a short list of people that were killed. Racial tensions within the United States became ugly, like they rose to very horrible levels. So, can I move that? There we are. So, the scenes and metaphors of Get Out. So there's a multitude of scenes that contain metaphors for racism in the current society. The first of which is at the park scene, the famous park scene within Get Out, where Chris is being surrounded by all the rich, old white people who, obviously we don't know at that point, but they're all just interested in his body and what it's like to be black and all that. And they were making very inappropriate comments to him, like, black is in fashion, and is it true that it's better? Obviously, being a very big sexual stereotype of black people. So they're all just saying very inappropriate things to him, which shows, even though they're trying to be nice to him and trying to be accepting of him, it's still racist. There's also the bingo scene, very famous scene, where the white people are literally bidding for Chris's body. Obviously, a call back to slavery, and our owners will bid for them. There's also the metaphor of the deer. I very much like this metaphor where Larry's quote, you know what I say? I say one down, a couple hundred thousand to go. I don't mean to get on my high horse, but I'm telling you, I do not like the deer. Sick of it. They're taking over. They're like rats. They're destroying the ecosystem. I see a deer dead on the side of this road, and I think that's a start. Now, the deer is a reference to black people who were hunted by white people, or in a way is a reference to how white people would kill black people in the society today, and kind of a lot of white people who did do that would keep them as trophies because of the deer head in there's a literal deer head trophy within the film that is representative of these white people who want to be black people, and they treat these bodies like trophies in a way. Okay, so just move you over there. So, Us, another one of my favourite films, and The Uncanny. In 2019, Jordan Peele, once again, graced us with another psychological thriller. This time, even though the cast is all black, well, the main cast, sorry, it's not about race or anything like that. It's more a dive into the uncanny. Now, the uncanny is a word used by Sigmund Freud in order to describe the strange and weird within a film. It was first used to create a threatening sense to the familiar, which is like us, so everything that seems normal. Yeah, the norm of what we are used to. A great example of the uncanny are things like toys and puppets, both are things that can simultaneously be innocent and frightening. Great example, obviously, is Chucky from Child's Play, in that it seems like a cute and innocent doll, but it's a cute and innocent doll that also murders people. So, you know what I mean? And now, the relationship between us and the uncanny, they have a very strong bond, I think, these two, in the fact that many elements of the uncanny show in this film consistently. The main one probably being the doppelgangers of the main family show up when they show up. We get to see how familiar yet different they are, like the character Zora, who is the daughter in the film, and her twin. They both have similar traits, as in they are both extremely fast runners. But the twin of Zora has an extremely uncomfortable smile on her face, unlike Zora. So it's just things like little tweaks like that that kind of make this film similar to The Uncanny. The scene which showcases both the surface and the underground and how similar they are is probably the best example of The Uncanny, as it literally is, if it's as if like the definition that Sigmund Freud came up with has been like taken and just thrown onto the screen. We see how the tethered, that's what they call the tethered act, how the tethered act the same as the people on the surface. So in, obviously in the scene with the scene at the beginning, the scene towards the end, where you see the people in the theme park and the few people below, and they're actually the exact same, but obviously the people on the underground have a more twisted and sort of like a broken doll look to them. Like, it's just like, it does seem like it's right, but it's just, it's, there's something weird about it. Now, this scene, there was one bit in this scene that I thought shows off the uncanny. It's really small, but it shows off the uncanny brilliantly, in my opinion. Yeah. So, like, throughout this scene, we see the main character, Adelaide, is constantly looking for stuff that seems out of the ordinary. Even though to us it seems ordinary, to her it doesn't. And we're constantly, as the audience, then, like this, as the audience, we're looking then for the uncanny. We're looking for what's different, but we can't see anything. But I love how when this happens, the uncanny, the uncanny element comes out of nowhere, in the fact that the frisbee covers the and she says that when the frisbee covers the dot, we kind of see the uncanny comes out of nowhere, and that's how it all starts. We know this film is going to be weird as soon as kind of that happens, in a way. So I just want to pick up on that. Hang on. So, the male gaze. Let's get into this one. So, what is the male gaze? Well, the male gaze is the idea that the audience of a movie is predominantly heterosexual men, and therefore most of the films made are made from their perspective, which leads to more female characters being extremely sexualized on screen. Many films have been guilty of this in Hollywood. As you know, when I looked into this topic, I found thousands. There's so many examples to choose from. And the example that I did choose isn't even an old movie, but I feel like what I have chosen is very interesting, because it kind of is the male gaze and kind of jokes about the male gaze in a way. So I'm sure we've all seen Jumanji, the new one. So first off, I'm gonna get this out of the way. Look at the photo. Look at the photo. This photo is like if the male gaze was a photo. So this picture is from the 2017 film Jumanji: Welcome to the Jungle, and it received backlash for having the only main female star in the film, Karen Gillan, dressed in a more revealing outfit than the rest of the cast, and you can even see it on the picture. It's obvious that Hollywood have clearly, it's obvious that Hollywood could have clearly been referencing the completely over-sexualized look of Lara Croft from the old Tomb Raider games and the Angelina Jolie films, as the film is about characters entering a retro video game, and sort of it's full of little nods to those games. But it's still obvious that women still get objectified in films, as Hollywood know that putting a woman in that kind of attire on a course will automatically attract like the typical heterosexual man to watch their film. Okay, so this scene is extremely interesting. Let me just press play to it.
Bethany, what did you tell her to do?
Did she twist her ankle, maybe?
She's never flirted before. Give her a break.
Hello, little lady. What are you doing out here all alone?
Hey, you guys. I seem to be lost. Can you guys help me?
Hello, little lady. What are you doing out here all alone?
That was so interesting and funny. What is she doing? Has she got a bug in her hair?
It starts off like that, and then as you get more into the clip.
You are a badass.
Yeah, here. Oh, this is where it gets really male gazing.
You guys like to dance?
But I think this is where it gets interesting, because it's really like over sexualizing, obviously. And then as you get into it, she does this.
She's kicking her ass. That's our girl.
Yes, queen!
She is destroying them.
Now, I thought that, so now see, I picked Jumanji because when I actually researched and looked into the scene, I found it really interesting, because I feel like it's a film that both shows that the male gaze is still predominant within film, as obviously we could see the completely over sexualization of the character. But also, I feel like in a way, Hollywood used that film to kind of mock the male gaze, as you noticed how they kind of used the film. It was more of a jokey way to put the point across. So they still over-sexualized the character, but then had a sort of beat up the men afterwards. So it was kind of showing that these over-sexualized women can be really badass and good and amazing characters. And I think also they used it as a way to mock it with the how bad she was at flirting with them. I think they used it as a way to kind of take the mick out of how badly sexualized characters have been over the years. But still, it still does show that it is kind of a problem within Hollywood. Yep. And that's all, folks. Thank you for listening to my amazing PowerPoint.
Well done.
Thank you.
Bravo.
Thank you.
It wasn't awful. It was good. Well done.
No, then.
Cameron, yeah. I like the touch with the what you've put in your frame.
It's because you were talking about Godzilla.
Yeah, I saw it.
I have a question.
No, I don't want to share my screen. Go away. Sorry. I'm trying to.
So my question is: so I've actually not seen the new Jumanji. I've obviously seen the old Jumanji. I've not seen that one. But do you reckon...
Emma, you need to watch the new one.
I really don't want to. But do you reckon that it kind of repurposes the male gaze, so she uses her, like, being sexualized to get what she wants? Do you reckon?
Yeah, definitely. So I just found it, yeah, I think it definitely does that. I just found it really interesting because, yeah, she does use like that.